Dear ladies and gentlemen, I feel deeply honored that I am the one who may present Robert Anderson's talk entitled The Morphological Aspects of Left Ventricular Pressure Load. In fact, he has sent a script to me where he wrote down what he would have said to each slide. And I also thank Christoph Stamm, who went through the images with me yesterday. So to start with, the left ventricular outflow tract has intrapericardial and extrapericardial components. The intrapericardial components have subvalvar, valvar, and supravalvar parts, and each part can be obstructed. The obstruction is subaortic with concordant, but subpulmonary with discordant ventricular arterial connections. So in the setting of transposition, all the lesions will produce subpulmonary obstruction. Time does not permit to demonstrate the counterparts seen when ventricular arterial connections are discordant. So I won't be able to show you images of this. This image shows the arterial pathways as seen in the neonate. The aorta on the left, pulmonary artery next to it on the right, and the arterial duct is still patent. This dotted line shows the approximate level of the pericardial reflections. This is important to distinguish the intra- and extrapericardial parts of the arterial trunks. Here we have the brachiocephalic artery, the left subclavian, and the left carotid left subclavian artery. This arrow points to the isthmus, and the second arrow, the arterial duct. And this encircled union of the isthmus, the duct, and the descending aorta is the crucial region for understanding coarctation. So coarctation can be associated with isthmal hypoplasia or the more uniform narrowing of the arch known as tubular hypoplasia. There's then a spectrum of malformation from tubular hypoplasia through atresia or to interruption of the aortic arch. This can affect the different components of the arch, but in the interest of time, we will only see images of the isthmus region. This image shows the appearance of the arterial pathways as seen from the front and from the left in the setting of a typical coarctation with a patent duct. These arrows point to the waist-like lesion at the union of the isthmus with the arterial duct. We have isthmal hypoplasia, and this third arrow shows the patent arterial duct. Coarctation in infancy usually coexists with a patent duct, but as we will see shortly, it can also be found when the duct has closed and has become ligamentous. This image shows the same view of the arterial pathways, but with tubular hypoplasia rather than isthmal hypoplasia. This bracket demonstrates the uniform narrowing of the arch segment that represents tubular hypoplasia. This arrow shows the patent arterial duct, and here we have the left subclavian artery. And in this instance, it is distal to the area of coarctation. So again, here we see pulmonary artery, ascending aorta, and the duct, and the descending aorta. Oh yeah, and the arrangement of the subclavian artery is another variable in the setting of extrapericardial obstruction. When the arch is interrupted, which will be seen shortly, then oftentimes one of the subclavian arteries takes a retroesophageal course. This image seen from the front shows atresia of the isthmus. This bracket illustrates the strand of atretic artery representing the isthmus. This arrow points to the dimple at the proximal end of the atretic segment. This second arrow points to the patent arterial duct, which feeds the distal part of the circulation. Going further, we see progression of the spectrum from atresia at the isthmus to interruption. The orientation of this specimen is the same as in the previous image. This star shows interruption at the site where previously there had been an atretic strand. Here we have the left subclavian artery. So the interruption is at the isthmus, and we see the so-called type A interruption. The arch can also be interrupted between the left common carotid and the left subclavian, which would be here, and then we would have the so-called type B interruption, or between the right and left common carotid, which would be here, and we would have a type C interruption. With each variant, there can be retroesophageal origin of the right subclavian artery, which is then the most distal vessel originating from the segment of arch fed by the patent arterial duct. And in this case, we have the arterial duct here shown by this arrow. Interruption of the arch is usually associated with other lesions, such as ventricular septal defect, but in this specimen, there is an aortopulmonary window, which is marked here with this bracket. We have seen this image before. It shows the waist-like coarctation in the setting of a patent duct. Coarctation, however, can also be found when the duct has become ligamentous, as shown in this right-hand image, where we look down at a pinhole coarctation shelf from the proximal side. This used to be called adult coarctation and can still go unnoticed until adult life. That is why it is so important always to check both in clinical examination, the radial and the femoral pulses. It is usual to categorize coarctation relative to the position of the duct, although this works only when the duct remains patent. With a patent duct, the coarctation lesion itself can be preductal, as we see on this left-hand image. It can be paraductal or postductal. The red bars indicate the flow through the patent duct. Morphologically, much more important than the location of the duct is the association with ductal tissue. On the left image, we see the normal situation when there is no obstruction of the left ventricular outflow tract. The ductal tissue does not encircle the flow pathway from the isthmus to the descending aorta. The right image shows the arrangement in the setting of an obstructed left ventricular outflow tract, the topic of the remainder of the presentation. Almost always, there is associated coarctation. This involves encirclement of the mouth of the isthmus by ductal tissue, as shown by this bracket here. And the association of ductal tissue and coarctation had been doubted for some years during the early 1970s, when I even wasn't born. And this association, however, had been demonstrated by two workers from Leiden, Professor Wilenga and Dankmeier. And the association was then emphasized, to use Robert Anderson's words, by the superb surgeon who worked in Leiden and popularized the arterial switch procedure, Professor Gerhard Brom, and whose picture we see here. This is a histological section showing the junction of the duct, the isthmus, and the descending aorta. It is stained to show elastic tissue. These two stars show the walls of the duct, which are muscular, lacking any elastic laminae. The arrows point to the wall of the isthmus, continuous with the wall of the descending aorta here. And they contain elastic laminae. The coarctation shelf marked by this star is made of ductal tissue. This is a crucial finding for the surgeon, since if all the ductal tissue is not removed, then there is a real danger of recoarctation. We now move on from coarctation to intrapericardial problems. Sorry. The intrapericardial component of the outflow tract has subvalvar, valvar, and supravalvar components. This is the way we are going to approach the remaining lesions. But how best to describe the valvar components? Currently, this is equivalent to the Tower of Babel. There's this recent paper published by the working group of German cardiac surgeons studying the aortic valve. And Robert Anderson calls it excellent and recommends us all to read it. And it is entitled The Everyday Used Nomenclature of the Aortic Root Components, The Tower of Babel. But why Tower of Babel? The dictionary definition for cusp is a pointed end where two curves meet. Many people, including me until yesterday, do not know that a cusp means the union of two points or the end of a pointed structure, such as the half moon. And the dictionary definition for commissure is the joint between two bones or the line where the upper and lower lips or eyelids meet. Here we see a diagram showing the arterial root. This circle marks the union of the leaflets at the sinuotubular junction. This is a meeting point of two curves, so this actually should be a cusp, should be called a cusp, this region here. And this star shows the leaflet, and this is what people incorrectly call a cusp. And it is better to be called leaflet. This image shows the aortic valve seen from above. The three arrows show the zones of apposition between two of the leaflets. If we used dictionary definitions, these zones should be called the commissures. In fact, the stars, these three stars, mark the peripheral attachments of these zones of apposition at the sinuotubular junction. It is these areas that currently are defined as commissures. So Robert Anderson recommends the audience, all of us, to avoid the use of cusp, since the leaflets are best described as leaflets. We should also recognize that the commissure is the end of the zone of apposition between adjacent leaflets. We should distinguish between the valvar leaflets and their supporting sinuses, and recognize the importance of the interleaflet triangles. We will move on to these few features when we discuss valvar anatomy, but first we will deal with the subvalvar area. This shows a peristalenal long axis view of the left ventricle. And this box emphasizes the aortic root. And we see a detailed view of this area here. We have the subvalvar area. The dorsal wall is made of the mitral aortic continuity. And the ventral wall is composed of the septum and the freestanding subpulmonary infundibulum. These black dots show the valvar area. We have semi-lunar arrangement of the valvar leaflets, and the valve occupies a significant length of within the outflow tract. And here we have the tubular aorta. The sinotubular junction is the union of the valvar and supravalvar components, and we will now see obstruction in each of these components. And first, of the subvalvar area. Subvalvar obstruction can occur with or without a ventricular septal defect. The lesions producing obstructions are the same, and remember that the same lesions can produce subpulmonary obstruction when the ventricular arterial connections are discordant. So subvalvar obstructions can be caused by deviated outlet septum, septal bulge, fibrous ridge or tunnel, tissue tags, or anomalous tension apparatus. And we will see important variants in the subsequent slides. This image shows the left ventricular view of a deviated outlet septum that produces subvalvar obstruction in association with the ventricular septal defect. We see the interventricular communication, the deviated outlet septum, and the narrowed subaortic outlet. This lesion is always associated, almost always, with the coarctation. It can also exist with a fibrous rather than a muscular outlet septum, as shown in the next slide. This image shows a deviated fibrous raphe associated with a doubly committed and juxtaterior ventricular septal defect. This is important surgically since there's nothing to resect when the obstruction is fibrous rather than muscular. So here we have this deviated raphe and the narrowed aorta. The other important lesion is the fibrous shelf, as shown in this slide. Here the ventricular septum is intact. There is a fibrous shelf marked by these arrows that extends all around the outflow tract, involving the aortic valvar leaflets and extending onto the mitral valve. It would be a mistake to describe this as a membrane. It is a fibrous diaphragm that can be removed by careful surgical resection, as shown in this next picture. This is the diaphragm that has been removed at surgery, taking care where it overlies the origin of the left bundle branch. This picture shows tissue tags. In this instance, there is a common atrioventricular junction and an atrioventricular septal defect. And now we are going to move on to the valve. Sorry. In valvar obstructions, we need to distinguish between valvar leaflets and their supporting sinuses, since it is loss of the semilunar attachments that is part and parcel of valvar stenosis. Fusion does reduce the semilunar hinge, and this produced the annular paradox. To understand that, we must examine the makeup of the aortic root. We see that by building up the valvar structure. The valvar leaflets are hinged within the root in a semilunar fashion. We see that in the picture of an open root here. Here we see the semilunar hinge lines, and the stars mark the three aortic valvar sinuses with the left coronary aortic sinus cut across to open the root. And yeah, this is the membranous septum. Here we see the aortic root in a diagrammatic fashion. The different components are shown with this red line, the anatomic ventricular arterial junction. Here in, with the blue line is shown the sinotubular junction. We have the semilunar hinge. We have arterial wall inside the ventricle. And we have ventricular muscle in the sinus. And then there's this rather virtual basal ring. Although this is the area that echocardiographers call the annulus, it does not correspond with any anatomic structure. And many surgeons do not call this part the annulus. So here we are again with the Tower of Babel. This image shows the crown-like attachment of the valvular leaflets. These are the parts seen by the surgeons when they have to cut away the diseased leaflets of stenotic valves. And these are the parts called by many the annulus. There are, however, additional rings within the root. The sinotubular junction, as shown in blue, in green, the virtual basal ring, and in yellow, the anatomic ventricular arterial junction. But which of these is the annulus? Probably the basal ring, but we cannot be sure. This image shows the annular paradox as seen in this unicommissural and unicuspid opened valve with loss of semilunar hinges and interleaflet triangles, the solitary remaining zone of apposition, and the narrowed sinotubular junction. This image shows a bicuspid valve. With the unicuspid valve, there was loss of two interleaflet triangles. In the bicuspid valve, there is a raphe between two of the potential leaflets, again with loss of the interleaflet triangle and loss of semilunar hinging. This points to the mechanism of stenosis. The different components of valvar stenosis are solitary zone of apposition, unopened zone of apposition, and vestigial interleaflet triangle. Now we move on to the last area of possible stenosis, the supravalvar region, which can be obstructed as well. Usually, supravalvar obstruction involves the sinotubular junction, and it can be hourglass, diaphragmatic, or tubular. This is shown by the cited article of Christoph Stamm and his study carried out when he worked together with Robert Anderson in his laboratory. This image shows a typical example of supravalvar stenosis. In fact, the major lesion is at the sinotubular junction. So the stenosis is really distal valvar stenosis. There are narrowed entrances to the sinuses, which results in leaflets that are longer than the sinuses. And often the surgeon will need to enlarge all of the sinuses. This completes our journey, and we will now summarize. Knowledge of normal anatomy is obviously a prerequisite for understanding the abnormalities. We need to recognize that there are intra- and extra-pericardial compartments. The intra-pericardial components has lesions at subvalvar, valvar, and supravalvar levels. And we need to distinguish between leaflets and sinuses. And to close again with Robert Anderson's words, he asks us all not to use the word cusp, since it is suitable, as he says, for describing the surface of the molar and premolar teeth, but useless when describing the heart. Thank you for your attention.